Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Call a meeting to order. Pledge of Allegiance. Okay, ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, roll call. Mary Helen, would you call the roll, please?
Pioneer Towns, oops.
You broke your own rule.
No. Pioneer Town seat vacant. Yucca Mesa to be vacant right now. Tom Ziegert will be sworn in tonight. Landers, Richard Lutringer. He is actually excused for two meetings due to two previously scheduled trips. He'll be back with us in October. Joshua Tree, Mark Lundquist.
Here.
Flamingo Heights, Lib Koenig.
Here.
Desert Heights, Pat Flanagan.
Here.
Wonder Valley, Teresa Seitz.
Here.
Morongo Valley, Gail Swearit.
Here.
Copper Mountain Mesa, Mary Helen Tuttle.
Here.
Okay, thank you.
I move we adopt the agenda.
Second.
Okay. Any changes, deletions? Okay, if not, do I hear a motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We had trouble with this one. Okay, swearing in of new member. Kurt, representing. Yeah, thank you. Hang on, let me find my sheet here. Yeah, I gave you one. Did I? No, I had one here. I got to find it, though. Hang on a second. Aha, I found it. Okay. You can read along because this gets a little interesting with the language on it. So please raise your right hand and state your name.
I, Thomas Ziegert.
Do solemnly swear or affirm?
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties upon which I am about to enter.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties upon which I'm about to enter.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you, Tom. Approval of minutes from June 13th, 2013. Are there any questions or additions or corrections on that? Okay. I have a first. Do I hear a second?
I second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so moved. Okay, down to me. We're moving right along here. Call for public comment. At this time, anyone may comment on items not on the agenda that are of interest to the public and within the jurisdiction of the MAC. The MAC is prohibited by law from taking action on matters not on the agenda. Comment may be offered on items on agenda when those items come up for discussion or action. A limit of three comments per item and 3 minutes per comment may be imposed. In all cases, if you wish to speak, please submit a registration card to the secretary and proceed to the podium when recognized by the chair. Speakers should address the MAC as a whole. Comments to individual delegates and or staff are not appropriate for this venue. Okay, let's see what we got first. I think we had first, do we have Ed? Ed Valorant?
Wait a minute.
No, that one works.
Turn it on, Ed.
Tap it.
No. Bob.
Okay, what am I doing wrong?
Well, then here, switch it with this one.
Ed Valoran, both Diamond Bar and Desert Heights. Recently, we had a special meeting talking about the fire service out in 29 Palms and the county area, Desert Heights. It's all service and under the management of the Water Board. And we've got a new Captain Chamberlain came up and presented some stuff. And I feel that, you know, it was a short time frame to get everything together and have some issues with it. And really, I think in my personal opinion, I think the answer is to keep the scheme we have and start employing a bunch of the people from Copper Mountain College as volunteers and keep costs down. I get some... Okay, is this better? Okay. There's some more view graphs on the chair there. I handed some out. And these are excerpts initially. These are excerpts initially from the presentation that was given last Wednesday. And I think that we've got money issues even with the scheme. On page 26, it specifies that what's being proposed by the county for 29 Palms is a three-person fire manning, which will be at the Adobe Station. The Lear Station, which is out in Desert Heights, is not being manned. And so, you know, we spent a whole bunch of money building that station. It's actually better than a downtown one, and it goes away. So page 26 shows the proposal that the chief had, which came out with $2,079,000. Then on page 29, he talks with us going to this FP5 rating at an increase from $80, the present rate, to $139.72, that they would wind up with only $53,000 left for capital after paying wages. Well, then I jump back to page 27 and look at all these one-time startup costs, you know, that come out to be $43,344 plus an additional $95,000 in 2017. That's more than twice the $53,000. So that says that we are immediately in financial problems with the solution that was proposed at that meeting. Then that doesn't go into the capital replacement needs, which are listed next, which is a $221,000. And then they talk about an engine cost of between $515,000 and $555,000. And a medic truck at $978,000. There's no money for all that, but yet that's listed as stuff that is needed. Also, we came out with, you know, was brought forth that presently the 29 Palms Fire is underfunded by $1.9 million. I don't see where that's addressed in here at all either. So I see us as a big underfunded condition, and I'm sorry about overrunning. Thank you.
Thank you. Hey,
Al Marquez, Sunfair area that comment is has to do with the commercial solar projects in the Morongo Basin. I have information from the county on land use, and I guess everybody is aware of the commercial solar project that has been over there by the Copper Mountain. I can't even think of it now. The Copper Mountain Dry Lake. And that was installed in, I think, 2014. And there's three other projects that we're supposed to be going forward with. One was in the west part of Joshua Tree proper along Alta Loma. And that one was withdrawn. And there was another one, that's called the Cascade Project, which is south of the existing project now close to the Copper Mountain College. And that one has also been withdrawn for whatever reason, I have no idea. And but there's still one that is proceeding right now, and it's under review, and that's over there at the Roy Williams or the High Desert Airport. That one is a 115 acres, including the airport, and supposed to be a 20 megawatt project. And right now it's under review by the county. And so I don't know how majority of the people in Morongo Basin feel about commercial solar projects in the Morongo Basin, but most of the people that I've talked to in the basin, they're against any commercial solar projects in the basin itself. Thank you.
David, you want to talk to me? I'll fill one out for you. It's my model. David.
David Fick,
Joshua Tree. And this is on and off. It goes. It needs a battery. Okay. Can you hear me?
If your voice is blowing into it, it'll stop working. You just probably hold it down and meet your chin. And don't point your face at it. There's a lot of rules to this game, apparently.
Okay, well, I'll just hold it here and just yell.
I have it
here. He's going to get it. Okay, first of all, I have a complaint about the county seal in the middle of the memo. It obliterates the information, half the information, mostly because of that choo-choo train coming out of the tunnel. And I would recommend that the seal be moved up to the right or something. Now, to continue the complaint about location.
Well, I'll take that on. That was my fault. I photographed them in a real hurry this morning.
Well, and you're right. The seal needs to be redone.
Oh, yeah.
So I'll take the blame on that. Thanks, okay. David.
Now, here's another request. That's the most viewed no smoking sign in this room, by the way, because everybody looks up and the clock ain't there. Where's our clock? It's got to be there. Now, the reason I was up here, because I'm not known to complain about clocks and forms, although I am a graphic artist. I was requested to say something about bobcats, and that's because I was the one that Tom O'Key called first. Now, I want to appreciate the sheriffs for being wrong again, because what they did, I told Tom to call the sheriffs. Tom called the sheriffs, and they said, you've got to give that trap back. You can't make it roadkill. You can't do anything. You can't put it on the highway. You have to give it back to the trapper. So, okay, following those rules, we made it into a hostage. We gave it to the newspaper. And the trapper talked to this young, good-looking reporter for, I don't know, probably half an hour. And then it became a news story, and then it became a 99 comment news story. And as that went on, during the comment period of close to a month, up came a website and up came the AB 1213 proposal. And history has been made. Most people know here that last Wednesday, it was August 5th, the Fish and Game Commission approved that 3-2 was a close one. 3-2, all bobcat trapping in California has been banned. So I'll leave it at that. So I thank the sheriffs for being wrong. We did find out later on that the trap could have been, it's abandoned property. If a trap is on private property, it's abandoned and can do anything you want with it.
Thank you, David.
I just would like to ask about that. I saw in the I think it was in the newspaper or it was online, that they have banned the trapping, but it's still legal to shoot them. It's still legal to hunt them. Yeah.
See, it was never about hunting.
Yeah.
Trappers get 6 months more pass.
Right, because it's all about the pelts. The pelts, baby.
May I suggest that Russ from the Sheriff's Department to address that, where they can hunt and where they can't? Is that something you're prepared for tonight? Okay, we'll do it. How about next time then? Maybe take a look. Okay, appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, Almet Fleck?
Good evening. I'm Ud Fleck, Wonder Valley. Seems we're putting out some minute details tonight. So let me start with, it's not that the police department or the recruiting only men, so the language should always be to staff. Staff. I don't know what these things are here.
Yeah, let's try.
Why did those mics work when you guys talked?
Thank you. Thank you.
Well,
thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Ah, you hold it like this. Now we go, right? You can hear me? So I insist that we encourage everyone, no matter what gender, to apply for jobs at the fire department and just talk about staffing. We had in Wonder Valley a meeting today that was very well run, and it was very effective in many ways. We had two gentlemen showing up. One is Ignacio Nunes. He is from the code enforcement, and the other one was Richard Anderson, Sheriff's Services Specialist. It was clear, though, to me that they're not familiar with Wonder Valley. Wonder Valley is a checkerboard, just like the landscape is, and it's very difficult to make quick decisions. It just fades in and out. I'm sorry, I'm not even touching it really. There we go. And in a way, it is frustrating that we always start again from scratch. There is no continuity. Apparently, people come and go very quickly. And so we have to educate again. We have to start from zero. And quite often, they're moved again in a short time. So I don't know how other communities deal with that. But for us, it is very frustrating. And after 10 years, I feel we have not reached where we should be. That's a long time. And it's the lack of enforcement. And it always comes down to we don't have the staff. And with the cleanup that is scheduled, and the county made some money available, and we do appreciate that. I don't want to be misunderstood here. It is great to have some help, financial help, to clean up, but it is a once a year program, and we don't know whether we have it next year. And the junk builds up faster than we can deal with it, do away with it once a year. So that's a problem. And the community is beginning to gel with our representative here. And we have a great group together. And we need to take more action. But we need the help with some of this stuff. And once a year is really not enough. If you can pass that on to the board, that would be wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alma. Next speaker, is it Faisal Alsari? Did I get that right?
Yeah.
Amazing. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. My name is Faisal Alsari. I'm a property owner in the Copper Mesa community. And I'm here tonight pretty much just to ask for your help. So 2 weeks ago, I could not access my property in a 4x4 all-wheel drive SUV. I think most of you haven't seen what happened up there, and I'm glad that you weren't up there, but the level of destruction was just devastating. I brought pictures because pictures speak 1,000 words, much more than I can do. I basically had to park over a mile away and walk to my property, and on the way I ran into a mom and a daughter that were stuck in the sand, that were using sticks to basically get their vehicle out. I ran into residents that could not leave their property. There was no way that people could get in or out of the majority of the Copper Mesa community. I was just shocked at the level of damage. And I don't think a fire truck could get up there. I don't think a police car could get up there. I will have to say that I've been in touch with the County Special Districts group and Public Works, and their work has to be commended. They stepped up right away. They're doing an excellent job up there, but basically the solution has to be to pave Winters Road. It is a public health safety issue. It's not a matter for me of discussion. I've pretty much documented it to a point where it's just not acceptable in the United States to have that level of road network for a community. And I've talked to a few people about it, and people say, well, you know, the investment's not up there. Well, I would argue that the level of investment is directly related to access and the quality of the road. So I just wanted to pass this around. Just to be clear, I'm not sure if I said, but we had Verizon DSL wires exposed. We had telephone wires exposed. You had county infrastructure that was fire hydrants two feet below of where it's supposed to be. We had the electrical substations there being tipped over. You had just a whole manners of destruction. Here you've got a picture of, it's about 4 feet below of. This was from that storm that we had 2 weeks ago. Yeah. Right, it was a result of the storm and the rain and the flooding afterwards. We are expected to get much more rain at the end of this year because of the El Nino predictions. This will happen again. And you can scroll through, I think. And it just was heartbreaking. It was just really sad. I couldn't believe it. I don't think it's acceptable. I don't think it's a combative issue. What I, as far as the county goes, I think that what I would like your board to agendize this item. There's a lot of people up there that would have come down tonight, but just work during the week and live out of the area during the week. My neighbor lives in Los Angeles. She was not able to be here. She actually, one of her vehicles got stuck at her property and couldn't leave from there. And the interesting thing, I've just been doing some research about this. So in 2007, this community actually designated Winters and Giant Rock Road to be paved. So it's been 8 years, going on 9 years now, where this community has kind of said, all right, this thing needs to happen. And I think I didn't know about that before this. If you had asked me a month ago, I would have said, and about paving Winters, I would have been indifferent. But after seeing the destruction, it is a safety issue, and there will be an emergency up there if we don't deal with this now. So thank you very much.
You want me to speak to that?
Yeah,
do. Do I have a choice?
No. So yes, I live out in the, I lived that. Lucky for me, I live right at the end where the pavement ends on Winters Road, so I was able to safely access and egress from my property. The special districts, and that is who takes care of our roads out there, special districts were, they came out, let's see, the storm was on a Wednesday afternoon. There was threat of the storm on Thursday. My phone was ringing off the hook, people calling, wanting to know what was going on. And the county doesn't act on it until, and I should say, the special districts doesn't act on it until they know there's not going to be further damage, until the threat of storm has passed. And so when they did, Winters Road was a, was rapids on the pavement. It was really something else. In fact, many of the, I saw some fire trucks, they had been called to help somebody whose water was rushing in their house. And the fire truck came up to the water rushing and said, no, we're not going anywhere. So it was really very, very dangerous. I've lived out there 15 years. This is the third time that that has happened. So maybe I'm getting a little immune to it. I don't know. I just stay put, I suppose. But so the special districts then initiated their, they had a load, I don't know the equipment, a moto grader and some big thing with a bucket. And they started right away working on, there's two known spots on Winters they were fixing, and then they continued on. And I have, if anybody lives out there and they, and special districts takes care of your roads, I have the number. It's they want the calls, the complaints to come into that office so they can keep track of them. Calling me is okay, but it's not gonna do you any good as far as getting your voice heard at county level. They need to know so-and-so's been calling, this is one's been calling, they need to document the calls. And they're very nice about it, and yes, more than likely they come out and take care of the issue. They've been parking the equipment at the community center all week long, actually. For the past 2 weeks, they've been out there.
Could we put that number on the Copper Mountain Mesa website?
Yes, I was gonna, yes. It's not a private number, it is public. So yes, we'll put it on the website. In fact, that's the other reason I brought it with me tonight. Thanks.
Mary Hill,
yeah.
Is Winters Road all of it a county main road?
Yes, it's all taken care of by special districts, except if the road, like my road, Sun Ever says, not maintained. So then it's up to us, my husband maintains it for us and anybody else that's on the road. Does he? You?
No.
Just a note, I don't have the website here, but there is on the county, if you want to peruse through their website, there is a map of what's maintained by the county. It's delineated in yellow, and there's and there also is, of course, the rest of the roads that aren't delineated in yellow are not maintained by the county. So before you call, you may have that information ready. If you live on a maintained road that is by the county, they will respond. If you live on a non-maintained road, they won't respond. It's up to the community to get together and do something about that. Not to say that pressure or calls would have them look at it and designate it a maintained road, although I don't think I've seen any here in the basin move to a maintained status in many years because of the budget. Tom?
And Mark, can I ask Mary Helen a question too?
Absolutely.
That? Mary Helen, do you have any idea how much of that road was, how Winters Road was supposed to be paved? I mean, is that where it goes now? Is that it? Or was there a plan to take it a lot further, like from where it is at that border?
Yes.
What?
Honestly, Tom, I haven't heard that the road was scheduled to be paved from border till Lear. The whole way you saw, Faisal?
Yeah,
yes?
So in 2007, it actually shows in the community plan that from border to Lear on Winters is supposed to be paved.
All the way to Lear.
Now, the community plan is a separate document.
Yeah.
Funding document. But, that's a big deal because for 8 years now, we've kind of had this on the books.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the pavement that's on Winters right now is something that we got. It was the leftover blacktop that was ground up when they were putting in the divider on the Yucca grade. And they wanted to actually put it in the Landers area, and at that time, the Landers Road Commission said, if you're not going to do all 500 miles, then we don't want it. And then they called up Copper Mountain Mesa, and Copper Mountain Mesa said, heck yeah, do whatever you got to do. So it's not true official road, but it's a pretty decent blacktop. It's a whole lot better. Winters Road used to be as damaged as you saw, Faisal, from the whole road all the way out to border. So yeah, but anyway, so then we got that. It's only pavement, I think it's like 3 miles from border just to Sunever. Yes, where I live, and that wasn't planned that way. It just kind of happened that way. Yeah, I know. But anyway, it just further shows the county that we do need a road commission. We need some place, we need to start with some organization for roads in the Wonder Valley area, Copper Mountain Mesa, in Flamingo Heights, Landers. Wherever there's dirt roads, people need a voice. So that only strengthens our cause.
Right. I know in Morongo Valley, people have talked about their dirt roads. And the thing that the county has always told us is, if you want a paved road, even if you're in a district, in a county district, to pave a road, it's really expensive nowadays. It has to be engineered. I mean, there's all kinds of things that have to happen. So if the people on your road want it to be paved, then the county is going to come back and say, you have to pay us to pave it. They maintain dirt roads. That's what your district is, to maintain dirt roads. But to actually put in a paved road, it costs hundreds of thousands of dollars. I know that's unbelievable, but that's just what we've been told.
Yeah, the current price, like Pat said, is $1 million a mile to pave a road.
Right.
Yeah.
Anyone who would like to know, just so we can end it for right now, the special district's road repair number is 909-387-5940, and the supervisor is John Bradsford, and I believe he reports to, either Millington or the other guy with the glasses. I can't think of his name. Millington's boss. Yeah. What's his name? Yes, Rigney, Jeff Rigney. I couldn't think of his name. Don't tell him that. Thank you for the focus on that. Thanks, Faisal.
For you, for those of you who want to look at what the maintained roads are in the county, these don't work well.
Mine was just working great.
Are you sure your mic was on?
Yes, it was.
I'm going to put this over on the table. There, I wrote down the
website to go to look at to get the county maintainer on the map. It's sbcountydpw.maps.arcgis.com. If you go to that, you can zero in on your area. The reason I'm saying that is they may not be maintaining roads as you think they should be. But if you find a road that's supposed to be maintained, then give the county a call. It may be just an oversight on their part. Although I have learned over the years, they're pretty good on maintaining roads in this area. They respond pretty quickly. But take a look at it. If they're missing something, let them know about it. And as a group, we will work on that and see what we can do. I'm not sure what the budget is in the county now, but we'll definitely take a look at it. Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, I think that's all.
No,
Peggy Lee, I almost forgot you.
Well, do I need to go upstairs?
Yes.
You have to use
my mic. This mic works good, Peggy.
Keep it a distance.
So, I live in Copper Mountain Mesa, and I got stuck. I got out the next day. And luckily I had a few cans of beans. I didn't have a cool pizza. But That's not what I want to talk about. There's some committees, I don't know what they are because they're not listed on the agenda, and I just want to encourage this board, MAC, to have the committees listed on the agenda and who the chairs are and maybe the contact information of the people so we know what's being worked on. That would be really helpful to know whether you should show up, that you want to address public comment that's not on the agenda, or maybe something that's on the agenda through a committee. I don't know. Because basically what I think that I'd like to see us focus on as a community is the poverty that is in our community. And I don't know how the MAC is doing that right now, but I'd really like to see us put in a shelter and a homeless shelter and maybe a transitional living and free showers in Joshua Tree, a real cooling center, and not say it's the library or the hospital. Like, how is a homeless person gonna make it to the hospital or for a cooling center in the, or a senior citizen without transportation? They're gonna go wait at the bus stop for an hour and die? So, it's these things that go with our poverty that we need to really look at and focus on. I think that would help us resolve a lot of issues that we are dealing with otherwise. I mean, it's nice that we're putting out all these fires all the time and fighting all these things, but it would be better if we were lifting up our community in substantive ways.
Appreciate it. Okay, let's go ahead and move to public safety reports. County Fire, who do we have tonight from County Fire?
Oh.
Rick, how you doing?
Can I use your microphone?
Only if you're nice to me, Rick.
I'll try. Thank you.
You hear me okay? Well, Faisal had a good point. I was listening to that. I've been up here almost 40 years now. It's not the first time I've seen it flood. So it is something that happens, and we all live with it. Anyone that's been here for a while, it happens regularly, something you have to be prepared for. One of the things he talked about was some of the utilities that we depend on. Some people that don't have or may lose cellular access, which we had happen just last week because of an incident in the low desert. We lost all 911 communications up here, including cell and landlines. I don't know if you guys knew that. We do have redundant and backup systems, and that's why I still continue to carry this. If you guys remember from 1980 crime shows, those systems are still in place in the county, and they're to keep us going when things fail. Underground utilities, power lines, overheads, poles, water systems, all that stuff gets lost. So remember, she had mentioned she had a couple of cans of beans available to eat, cases of water, all of those things. You guys have a great community. You guys are the leaders of your communities, otherwise you wouldn't be here. But to network, do a little checklist, check on your neighbors when we lose access to them. Emergency services sometimes get overwhelmed on incidents like that. Your request because of flooding in your front door and out your back door is probably going to go to the rear of the call order when someone's trapped in their vehicle being threatened to wash down a wash. So there's a lot of things that happen. And emergency services with the CHP and the sheriff certainly too get overwhelmed at times at the peak of those incidents. So remember, sustainability, self-sustain, have those things back up. You have to have cases of water and stuff like that if it is a day or so longer. But anyway, I wasn't going to talk too much about that, but I just thought it was a great point. Ed started off by some questions about that were recently brought up in proposals at 29 Palms. He was kind enough to go through and notation on the presentation that was made, and I'll bring that to Chief Chamberlain to discuss. So he'll get back to Ed. I gave him my contact information, and I'm hoping that we can communicate back and forth. One thing I wanted to talk about is, did you guys see a lot of smoke in the air tonight in this area?
Yeah,
there's a fire over in Anza, just on the other side of the mountains. So it's burning, they have evacuations, they have structures that are threatened. It's very typical this time of year. But what I wanted to bring up to you is we recently had the lake fire that was threatening a lot of our communities, as you know, Pioneer Town again, Morongo Valley again, those kinds of things. I was working the last couple of days in Arizona. I went over to right out of Mojave Valley. There was a fire there. It's now, last check it was about 6,000 acres. I bet it's probably closer to 6,500 or more now. Lost 11 structures. There were a lot of things that were going on in that, and the reason that the fire got so big is a lot of people thought somebody else called on the fire, and we found out later that people in Arizona goes, oh yeah, I saw it when it was real small. Well, it's typical, kind of like with the Homeland Security thing. If you think about it in your own community, and you know when something's just not right, it's okay to just check with your neighbors, see if they're fine, or call and at least notify someone that there is smoke, there's sight of it in the area. While that's not San Bernardino County, our neighbors, we help them right across the river in Mojave Valley as they help us when we need help over here. So it draws us down when these things get larger. You've seen a lot of it in these large fires in Northern California, Oregon right now going on. Right now we have 9 incidents that we're supporting out of San Bernardino County to other areas. Those include Northern California and Oregon incidents. We've sent over about 9 overhead people, engines and strike teams and crews to help those people put those fires out. Those communities depend on us through mutual aid systems, just like we depended on them when you saw all those people visiting us in Pioneer Town during the Sawtooth or the Millard Fire. Dulce, we've had many fires up here, even in the park. Those systems get overwhelmed, and it's neighbors helping neighbors, and that's how that works. So right now we're pretty much on drawdown because they're having all the problems like we did a few weeks ago. That's about it. We have a few things coming up in the community. We have a new truck that's going to be delivered here. Ed mentioned the cost on that. We have about $800,000 in this new truck. It's the newest one of the community. The last one was brand new in 1991 for this area, and it just reached its service limit. So not just that, it's that laws and OSHA regulations change and they're no longer applicable or serviceable because of AQMD even. The engine was not legal anymore to run in the state of California. That's just how it is. And so those things push us into these newer pieces of equipment, and it has a vision of lasting once again for 20 or 30 years. So it is something that if you take that and break it down, but it is a beautiful engine. We'll have it in town starting next week to start showing people the truck company that's there, and it will service any request within the Morongo Basin. And we hope to have it at the Pioneer Days parade that's coming up in October. And also the traveling Vietnam Memorial Wall will be coming through Yucca Valley, and we hope to have it there also. Just in support of all these public activities, we want to be out there and let them know that we're visible, and certainly call us at any time. I brought also to leave on the table a couple things and some of my cards too. Our website is on the card. You that know anybody in the community that wants to get involved, Ed talked about volunteers and PCFs and things like that. We have a lot of programs, and we're really seeking people that want to get involved in the community, and then young people too that would like to consider possibly emergency services for a career. And it's kind of our obligation for succession planning to find others that will help us be safe in the future. So I'll leave some of that, and if you have someone that may be interested, grab one. Any questions for me? Yes. Currently, that is a problem for us. The station downtown was built in 1959, and it doesn't quite have the head height for it. We're getting some work done, and you know how you can raise the bridge or lower the river? We're going to lower the floor, more than likely. So at this time, it will be out on our Yucca Mesa station. It's a much larger station built in the 70s. It has larger bays, but ultimately, it will be stationed downtown in the middle of Yucca. Yes. I don't see why not. Let me hand you my card. You probably already have it, but make sure, okay? Absolutely. There you are. Yeah, that would be great. That would be fantastic. Yeah, we'd love to see it get out there. You know, it's a tool that we're very proud of. It's taken years and years to get to this point of saving to buy this, and it's not. While it's stationed in Yucca Valley, stationed there, it is something that the county recognizes as part of the county. It's part of these communities here, and all the departments here will request it as we request them. Kind of like I opened when I spoke about fire departments helping each other. The equipment's the same way. Not everybody can go out and buy, you know, an $800,000 fire truck. So that's it. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
I was curious, do they make fire
Yeah, actually, they do make them, and we do have them. Yes, if you'll notice in areas, we have one stationed at 19, we have one stationed at 45, our station in Needles. These are called brush patrols. They're all-wheel drive. They're built on an F-550 chassis. They have pumping capabilities, extrication tools, paramedic equipment, but they're just a little mini unit. And those are very common throughout the county. It's getting to be a model that we use. Most of them are four-door right now, so they can hold a crew of four. Some are two-door.
Are they all $300,000?
No, sir, no. I don't know the price on them, but they're definitely more reasonable. You can get a handful of those for the price of one truck. And we also have a new four-wheel drive engine. The one that we have currently in Yucca Valley, it's stationed on the Mesa because of issues like you had spoken about of flooding and dirt roads, having a large network of those out there. It's all-wheel drive. It sits really high. I mean, it's two steps just to get into it from the ground. And it's been beat up. It has hundreds of thousands of hard dirt miles on it. It's met its service limit. It was put in service in 1996, and a new one will be arriving there next year. And it is a smaller fire engine, all-wheel drive. So as the patrol, or as we call it, the smaller ones, get exceeded for their ability to meet the emergency need, then the engine, and then the truck is saved for large commercial incidents and things like that. It's not driven every day everywhere. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
The fire station that's over there by Panoramic Heights, south of the highway, is that being utilized?
It is utilized currently, but it's not a full-time station. It's one of the areas that we put on training events, and it's primarily where most of our CERT instruction, trailers, and classes take place for the community emergency response teams. All right, thank you very much.
Thanks, Eric. Appreciate it.
Good,
yes, sir. She's got a great schedule. This is two meetings. Yeah, she's on vacation a lot. Yeah. Me too. Yeah, the funny thing is, she always tells me when she's going on vacation. There's no asking or signing up. She just says, hey, I'm going on vacation again, and it just so happens another meeting comes along. So here I am. I really didn't have a lot this evening to talk about unless there's a bunch of questions, but I did want to thank the community. Most recently, we had those bridge washouts down on the 10 freeway, as you know, and we had a lot of traffic come through town. And it was a tough week and a half here. We probably quadrupled our traffic. And I just wanted to thank the community for the efforts of patience and understanding, because it was directly routed up here. That was on the Caltrans webpage, on our webpage as well. And really, as you know, the community, there's no other way around. It's very difficult for us, and we asked for extra patrol to come here, and I think that helped us out a little bit, but I want to thank everybody for that. And piggybacking on what Rick had to say about when we have these large floods and in these large fires, you know, there's been times where we've shut down freeways and major corridors, and people have been stuck in their vehicles. They've spent the night with them. So may I ask that you might want to think about adding a little bit of water to your vehicle, add a little bit of food, some dry goods, and maybe a blanket or two, especially during the winter, and just have that available to you and to your loved ones in the event there is a problem sometime and we have to shut down a highway and maybe a flash flood and there's no place for us to take you. And we're stuck there all together, because I've been stuck in the snow up in the Cajon Pass more than a few times, because we just don't have vehicles or sometimes the manpower or the ability to leave ourselves, much as get anybody else out. We just want to be safe, and that's what's most important to us. Any questions for me? Yes, sir. You know, I don't really have a lot of information for that. I understand that it goes from 65 to 45 through Joshua Tree. Now, it's been my experience and a lot of other places that I've worked, it's because of the amount of businesses and the pedestrian traffic that come through. Now, since I've been here, it's been a little over a year now, we have had a few incidents in there, and I know we've had several near misses, and in fact, I've asked my officers to contact the pedestrians, and we have so many visitors here, and they look across that street from the pizza place or maybe from the liquor store, and that's a short distance to run, but they don't realize that it's a 45 mile per hour speed limit sign. But however, people seldomly go 45. They are usually doing 60 Yes, sir.
Also, when they did take a speed test, they took it at the cemetery. This is for the speed of downtown Josh Street. They took it at the cemetery on the highway where vehicles are coming downhill at 70. And then they tell us the 85% average is way up there for downtown Josh Street when they should take it in downtown Josh Street, shouldn't they?
I don't know how they do it. To be honest with you, they post a sign, and that's what we enforce. My suggestion is perhaps you direct your concerns to Caltrans. Maybe they can come to one of our meetings, and we can ask about that. Yes, ma'am.
Could you get a ticket if you drove through there at 35?
There is an impeding law. Uh-huh. But if you're driving at 35 miles per hour, maybe because you're unfamiliar with the area, or maybe because there's a lot of water in the road, or it's foggy, or there's sand blowing across them, you know, sometimes 5 miles per hour would be the correct speed. Sometimes that happens. And we all run into those folks. You know, at 35 miles per hour, it does create somewhat of a hazard if you're going anything below the speed limit. But sometimes it's understandable, and it's the reasonable speed to travel. Yes, ma'am.
Conversely, have you ever given anybody a ticket for jaywalking?
Yes, ma'am. In fact, that's happened a little more frequently because of our pedestrian incidents. I've asked my officers to address them.
Will you ever get like a foot patrol there? And, you know, I mean, I saw somebody today coming from the health food store right over to the... I wanted to tell them, hey, stupid, you're going to get hit. Watch me.
Well,
I know that's bad. I'm sorry.
Most recently, I actually contacted somebody myself, and they were less than receptive to my just asking him to walk the 100 feet to the signal light and push the button. But, you know, we run into all kinds of folks, and my expression to that person was, I'd rather meet you this way than in the back of an ambulance or worse. So I'm going to continue to do my job, and so are the folks that work for me. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to say, the man that was killed here a couple of months ago, he had a family and people who really cared for him, and it's...
I would agree with you 100%, and like I've said before, one of those accidents is too many. And I know we have a lot of near misses, and that's why we're trying to focus our enforcement. So maybe 45 is the right speed, maybe 35 is the right speed. It's not my call to make. If should you want it to change one way or the other, my suggestion is to contact Caltrans, and they have a very resolved method of doing studies on these, and I'm sure they'll contact us for our statistics. But again, whatever the speed limit is what we enforce. Anything else? Anybody? Well, we do put that radar trailer out there periodically. I know we do that coming eastbound, and there is a 45 mile per hour ahead sign leaving from the mortuary out this way, and that does help. I realize it's a downgrade and you have a very nice line of sight, and when you're paying attention to the beautiful valley that's out here, sometimes it's hard to pay attention. And me too. And we've met some of those folks, and again, we have a lot of visitors, we have a lot of travelers that are passing through, and it's a constant concern for us.
Yeah.
It actually belongs to Caltrans, but I am familiar with it, yes.
Because it's a one-way conversation for the filming, and maybe if you could repeat their question.
Okay.
And then we won't have to go into a padded cell and have a lecture after this is over.
I'm sorry. So the speed limit sign really helps. Is that your guys's?
So you're asking if the speed limit sign helps. Is that the mobile trailer, the little orange flashy? Actually, that does belong to the Highway Patrol. That is ours, and we maintain that.
Uh-oh.
Yeah,
those really help. I think
they do. We try to move it around and deploy it. But even if you don't see it in Joshua Tree, it doesn't mean it's not someplace else in the community. But it is a two-man deal to take it out, and we have to secure it a proper way to make sure it's charged. And that's always a concern for us. And we have to, believe it or not, every once in a while they get vandalized, and that we don't want that to happen as well.
Is that the one that you have in 29 Palms?
29 Palms is the contract city. I think the sheriff's department has their own.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else?
Yeah, but basically, the MAC several months ago did request that the county send a letter to Caltrans and explain the speed limit, the 45 through Joshua Tree. And we did report it at the MAC, and it was on the MAC site, as I remember. I did post the letter. And basically, it said it might be an enforcement problem for you in their speed test. They also cited the speed test, and when they did it, I'm not sure, David, whether they cited the exact location where they did the test or not, but I can pull up that letter and bring it to the next MAC meeting. It was reported on the radio also and in the newspaper. They did agree to put pedestrians ahead signs on both sides of the highway in both directions, so we can expect that. That was something. So we did get something out of the inquiry out of it. So hopefully in the near future, you will see signs approaching downtown Joshua Tree that indicate watch for pedestrians. Hopefully it'll help. Thank you.
Thank you. Lieutenant Wilkie.
Thank you very much. I haven't been here for a while, so I'm glad to see you all again. The captain had another arrangement or engagement tonight, and so he asked me kind of last minute to be here, so I'm kind of glad to do that. And the one thing that I wanted to talk about, and then I'll get into some other things, because some good issues came up tonight and some good questions, and I'd like to talk about those. But one of the things you remember me coming forward about, I don't know, 8 months ago, the sheriff in the county is really committed to trying to get additional deputies out to the county areas. We received one of those already. That doesn't seem like a lot, but that makes a big difference for me. And we just got another one. So we've got another one who's coming into the mix. That's great because it puts someone else out on opposing shift, and it's a really good thing. This person will have to go into a field training program, so there's a little bit of time while they're trained up, but then I'll have another person out there in the county areas, and so that's really good, and I thought you'd be glad to hear that at least. So that's two more now. Some of the other things that came up that I'd like to talk about, the traffic trailers, you asked about 29 Palms. We have traffic trailers like that, the radar trailers, in Yucca and 29 Palms. You won't see them all the time. Sometimes they're vandalized, like Eric was saying, and sometimes they break and they go down. They have to go out for maintenance. Most recently, the 29 Palms trailer needed to be maintained, and the unit that's the radar unit for that has to be taken all the way down to Long Beach to be worked on. It took a little while to get it back. It is back. It needs to be calibrated, and then you'll see it back in service again. So we move as quickly as we can on that because it's a very effective tool. It does work. It tends to slow people down. As far as where people can hunt in the area, I don't know anything personally, and won't claim to because I don't want to be wrong, about trapping animals. I know hunting is regulated by the state. You have to have a state hunting license. You have to have permits for certain areas. I will look into that and find out what the areas are around here. But I know that it's state regulated. Someone brought up the different genders for law enforcement, and I would like to encourage everybody, please, if you know anyone you think is qualified or would make a good deputy sheriff, encourage them to apply, because we're looking for people all the time that are good people of all genders, especially in areas like this. It's really good if you get local people back into the area, because then you maintain consistency and you have the same people in place for a long period of time. When they're further out of the area, that's not so much the case. You brought up Robert Anderson is most recent. You brought up about Wonder Valley. He is new back up here to work in this area, but he's a resident here and he lives here. And we specifically sought him out for that purpose because it puts someone in the community who's a resident here. So as soon as he gets to know some of the people in Wonder Valley, you're probably gonna be, it'll be very beneficial to have him as the person that's serving you out there. I think you'll be very happy with it in the long run. But that was the thought process behind it. There is attrition. We do lose people. People retire. Sometimes they get hurt and they're retired. And so there's a constant ongoing turnover. But we're always trying to bring good people up into this area. So if you know anyone, please send them to us. Recruiting is something that we're always looking to do. We test monthly now for the jobs. And they can go online and find out about how to apply for that. One other thing I wanted to talk about, fire department brought up, was the loss of the 911 that we had a week or so ago. In case you don't know, there are systems and backup systems, many of them in place, and we were working very closely with the fire department. You have a very unique community up here, and I know some of you know that and some of you may not realize it, but you really do. I live in the valley, and it's not so much like that down there. You have volunteer groups and people that really do a lot of work to help the community. And some of those people are the ham radio operators. And they were being staged all up and down different places along the highway so that if the system stayed down, people would have a location they could go to report a crime or ask for assistance. That was already in place and happening, and they were starting to deploy. And we got lucky, and the system came back up quickly. So we were really glad for that. But just know that there was being acted on fast. Within an hour, that was in place and starting to happen. So had it occurred, we would have probably contacted the local radio station. It would have went out on the radio and told you where you could go to report things if you needed them, so that we had some kind of system in place, even though we didn't have any kind of phone capabilities at the time. So that's pretty good. And lastly, I don't know if I was fortunate or unfortunate, but I was the one that ran the sheriff's command post for the fires that we talked about when we had them here, and all the evacuations that happened and whatnot. I just want to say thank you to everyone in the communities, because you work very well together, and it makes it a lot easier. It really is a gem. I say that over and over, but I'm telling you the truth. The cooperation that the people have with one another here is phenomenal, and I appreciate it. And I appreciate the help from Highway Patrol and the Fire Department, because never have I worked anywhere where that relationship was as solid as it is here. So that's about all I had to say, and I'll take questions if you have them. Yes, sir. Honestly, I don't know the answer to that. I don't know how that's recovered or who cut that or what took place. I just know it happened, and I know that it caused me to have to do a lot of things here. That's above my pay grade, so to speak. I don't know the answer to that. I'm sorry. Yes, ma'am.
Do you know the status of the three gentlemen who were electrocuted in 29?
No, I don't. And
okay.
And may not be able to share some of it if I did. I apologize for that, but I don't know the current status, no. Yes, sir.
We're having problems with off-road vehicles on dirt roads. It's involved, it comes every once in a while, but during the summer, they have more problems on that. Do you have any suggestions how we can alleviate that problem?
This comes up every year, too. It's a problem for us. We have off-road enforcement teams that go out. We have people we put out on motorcycles as well. They go out in four-wheel drive vehicles, and we try to address the problem. But I don't have as many of those as you have people running all over the desert, and I can't be everywhere when it seems like we need to be there. All I can ask you to do is continue to call us and let us know, or if you see a vehicle that dropped it off or let, you know, towed other vehicles into the area. Don't jeopardize your safety ever, but if you could get a license plate or something like that, it would help immensely. So most of the time you'll call, and by the time we get there, they're long gone, and it's aggravating for us as well. But we do work that pretty aggressively, and we do achieve some success and results. I just don't have enough people to be everywhere all the time, and that's the problem with that. So just please be vigilant on your own and call us if you have a problem. And if you can get a vehicle description or a license plate, if one exists, if you can get that, that would be very helpful. Just don't ever confront anyone or endanger yourselves when you're doing so. Yes, ma'am.
You know, we have a lot of illegal shooting.
Mm-hmm.
A lot. And it's just
kind of
threatening. Some of it's threatening. And then some of it's people that like to come from the desert to the wild west. They can do whatever they want. And because of the patchwork situation with the BLM, and I recently talked to the BLM, and they said whatever the county law is, we follow that. But then there's always this issue of what property they're on. So I don't know what the solution is, but a couple of months ago, we had some high-power rifle shots over our property while I was out in the area, and it was really dangerous. From somebody that came and rented a cabin up the street and Airbnb thing, and supposedly, because, you know,
Anyway, so the sheriff responded, and on the way up there, he stopped and talked to an illegal off-roader. And then he went up to the house where we thought it was probably coming from, because the other neighbor on the other side said there was M80s going off there the night before. And the officer left and basically said, well, it seemed like a really nice couple from LA. So, you know, I mean, it's good because the cops did go there, the officer did go there, it's good. And then it did stop. And, you know, I didn't want anything bad to happen to anybody, but it was dangerous. It was a dangerous situation, and it happens out here. So I don't know what the solution is, but I think that I would really like to see law enforcement at least react like it's dangerous, because these people are kind of stupid, come out here and shoot like that, you know?
The incident you're describing, I don't know if it's the same, but it sounds very familiar to a couple that I've dealt with. I can tell you that we've been to things like that. We have arrested people and prosecuted. Without being on that specific call, I don't know the facts or what led up to it or didn't. They're dealt with on a case-by-case basis, because that's usually how they come in. But if there is a violation of law, they're usually, I mean, we make arrests and we prosecute those cases. I came about a year and a half ago at the request of everyone and provided the links and the information for the legal shooting areas.
One of those maps was really incorrect, by the way.
Here's part of the problem with that. What I gave you is the most current county map. And they seem to conflict somewhat with BLM. I know that from the county side, we're going to act on the county maps. And the ones that I provided were the most recent ones that I had. I can send that link again, if you'd like, to someone on the board to pass out. And I offer to do that, because it was very difficult to navigate that system and find that information myself. I had a hard time, so if I had a hard time, most people probably would as well. I'm more than happy to do that. It is the most accurate information that I have at this time, and that's what we use to go by. I understand that some of the maps from the Barstow BLM office are slightly different. I can't answer for that. I can tell you in this area, we enforce them based on the maps and the shooting areas that we have from the county, and the most current ones I can provide to you.
And then there's rules about the shotgun.
There actually are areas out here for rifle fire as well.
But it's further out. Mm-hmm. So it's not in this general area.
Okay.
It's not in Joshua Tree. So this was in Joshua Tree.
Okay.
So, but, you know, there's people that have firearms, and I don't have a problem with that. But when you're shooting at us, I have to have a problem.
I understand.
There's the stuff that will go through.
Right. I understand.
So, it was like a war zone. And the officer showed up, which was really nice, but then it's sort of like,
Yeah, without me having the benefit of knowing what, I don't know what took place or what discussions were had. I'm giving you the best answer I can based on what you're telling me. But if it's something that's endangering someone's safety, I'm telling you, we take it serious. I wasn't there, so I don't know all the circumstances, but we arrest and prosecute for that very frequently.
We get a lot of automatic weapon fire up there, so.
I know. I suppose this is comforting, but it's not unique just to this area. That's pretty common in any place where it starts to become kind of rural. Yeah. I understand.
I emailed him. Anyways. So I just wanted to bring it up, because I think it's really dangerous that, and it should be treated that way.
I understand.
Okay, thank you, Russ. We appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, Lib would like to introduce our next speaker or presentation.
You know that I'm a volunteer junkie, and One of my things that I do, I was appointed by the supervisors in 2010 to the Senior Affairs Commission. One of the committees that they have is intergenerational. And through that, we met Cindy Lopez from Helping Hands in Victorville. And she's going to be our speaker tonight. And really listen, because this is something that really needs to be addressed up here. And everybody seems to be embarrassed to say, I'm taking care of my children, or, you know, my mother isn't here, I'm being taken care of by my aunt and my uncle. So, Cindy, would you come up and give us your information?
Do we have one that works well? Is that the one, Mary Helen?
Okay. You know, there was no problem if they held it in the right place.
Just hold it like in this. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, just right here.
Hi, everyone. My name is Cindy Lopez. I'm the program manager for Helping Hands Kinship. And this is Elizabeth Sandoval. She's the crisis case manager in Victorville. And I'm here to talk to you about our Helping Hands program. We are stationed out in Victorville. We have a center in Victorville, and we have a center in Ontario. And as of last year, we are now providing services in Yucca Valley. We usually come out, we don't have an office here, but we will come out and meet one-on-one with the families. So let me tell you a little bit. We are a kinship support services program. We work with relative caregivers. We work mostly with, I would say about 80% with grandparents raising their grandchildren. We work with formal and informal cases with children and family services. Right now, formally, there's about 6,000 children in formal foster care, where a social worker actually had to come into the home and remove the child from the bio parent for whatever reason. And I would say about 4,000 of those are being raised by relatives. So it's a high number of relatives that are raising other children. So in our centers, however, there's about 144 families enrolled in Victorville and about 147 in Ontario. In Yucca Valley right now, we have four families in Yucca Valley where that we're actually working with and coming out to see and linking to community services and community partners in the area that can help the families. So let's see, well, I'm gonna talk about how the caregivers feel. A lot of times the caregivers feel lost. They don't know how to navigate the system. They don't know what they're really getting into by getting these children. A lot of times I would say they're in the junior high age, so their grandparents raising junior high. There's even some raising some two-year-olds. I don't know if it's feedback or something. So, you know, they don't really know how to deal with it. A lot of kids come with trauma. They come with mental health issues. It could be behavioral issues, academic issues. There's so many things that the caregivers have to deal with or work with the children. So then we help the caregivers link them to whatever, you know, they need to help them succeed in the home. A lot of times they feel like, okay, the social worker dropped off these kids in my home, yet they're not helping me, they're not working with me, they're kind of just, here you go, here are your grandkids, and bye, good luck. So then they're like lost, and a lot of people don't even know about our program, or they don't even know that we exist, but we help them navigate through the system. We help them get their financial situated. We help them get Medi-Cal or insurance for the kids, connect them to doctors, connect them to whatever mental health professionals they need to work with. Educationally, if we need to work with the school, we'll work with the school. There's so many different ways that we work with the family, with the caregivers. So we kind of help alleviate, you know, the situation. We kind of help the children transition into the home and kind of be okay, stabilize and everything. How do the children feel? The children feel lost. They feel traumatized. They're being removed from their mom, so, or their parents, you know. So then when they go to a relative, they feel a little better instead of actually going into foster care with random strangers. This way they're with relatives, either grandparents, aunts, uncles, even a godparent is considered a relative with our program, or a neighbor if they grew up with them, you know. So we help the children, again, with whatever their issues. They're feeling lost, they're feeling lonely, they're feeling abandoned, they're feeling sometimes embarrassed, honestly, because, you know, my mom was young and hip or whatever, and now it's a grandparent, and the grandparent just doesn't understand the child because of the whole generation gap. You know, it's different, different music, different culture, different population. So we work with the children as well. We help them kind of understand what they're going through, understand that they're not alone, understand that there's so many families going through the same thing. So I'll talk about the services that we offer. The first thing that we do offer, and that is very popular in our programs, are support groups. And I'll have Elizabeth talk a little bit about the support groups.
Let's see if I can manage this right. Hello, everybody. For support groups, they are every Monday from 10 to 12. And really what it is an open forum for the grandparents or any other relative or caregiver, I should say, that's there. And they're there to talk about however they're feeling, if they need any other sources that we can help them. And if they do, we pull them aside, we take them into our office, and we do talk about if we need to refer them to either counseling or any other source. For example, we do deal with a lot of low-income families, but we do have some cases that are not, and they just need counseling, or they just need our support. So on Mondays, we're there for them.
And currently, we don't have a support group in Yucca Valley because we haven't had the need or the interest yet. We are working with Pacific Clinics that's stationed out in Yucca Valley, and they recently started a kinship support group. We work with them to kind of give them guidelines of how we work it out and how we facilitate it. And so they have that there. Last week, they said they didn't have any participants yet because most of the families that we work with work during the day, so they don't have the opportunity to go. But if ever the need, I always tell our families, if you ever want a support group, we will be out here. We will come out and we will sit with you. But I think also because we work one-on-one with the family, so maybe that's why they don't really know, it'll help them. Recently, we do family activities out in Yucca Valley. We took our families bowling one time, and so that kind of connected our families that are up here. So we will definitely do events, and so if there are families that you know of, we won't leave them. We'll be there for them depending what the families need. Other services that we work with, that we help with, resources, like she said, back to school clothes, backpacks sometimes when we have them, clothes. Today we had a bunch of clothes donated from Children's Fund, so then we call them up, we email them, hey, we have clothes. I was working with Liv, she said she was telling me about this program that's gonna help with shoes. So I mean, we, you know, keep the families connected to whatever the families need. And if there's a family that needs utility assistance and their gas is gonna get shut down, we work with a family in Yucca Valley where Department of Aging actually helped pay for their utilities. So if there's something that the family needs, we'll be there to help them. It's pretty much whatever they need, and we research it. And that's why we like to come to these kind of things too, to put our name out there, and I get your guys' information. So if there's ever a case or a family that I just really don't know where to go, I'll come to you guys or, you know, ask questions. And I think that's pretty much it in a nutshell. Do you guys have any questions for me? Yes.
You're a 501c3, so you're a nonprofit.
Yeah.
How do you acquire the funding to carry on the project?
We are county contracted. It's a state program, and they fund the county, and then the county contracts out. So there's three kinship centers. There's the one in Victorville that helps all of the high desert, Big Bear and Yucca Valley. And we also run the one in Ontario, all the east, never sure, or that side of it. And then there's the San Bernardino one, West Side Kinship Support Services, that works with San Bernardino. Mm-hmm.
Years ago, I was working with the school district in a lot of discipline issues. And at that time, when this was probably 5 or 6 years ago, we had a lot of grandparents that had kids with discipline problems, and we got involved in those meetings. And I agree with you, the grandparents didn't have a clue as to how to raise the children. You know, they'd raised the first set, and the second set was very difficult for them. But I never encountered a counselor come in with the grandparents into these meetings for any kind of solutions. Is that something you do now?
Yes.
If you're called, will you participate in a school discipline meeting with the grandparents and the administrators?
Yes, definitely. And that's one of the things that a lot of grandparents just don't know how IEPs and behavioral meetings work. So we go in there and kind of advocate and let them know what kind of rights they have. And if for some reason we can't, we connect them with somebody who can. And definitely, you know, one of us will be here.
So they would,
grandparents would just have to get a hold of you and you would do it as part of your program from the county.
Yes.
Thank you.
And I left business cards in the back, and then Lib also printed our support group flyer with all our information, our phone number, and then I did, you know, too, just more about facts and all the three different centers in the county of San Bernardino. And the program's free. The only qualification is that you're a relative caregiver. So income, high income, low income, any, it doesn't matter. You know, you need support, we're there for you.
And what rights do the parents have to take the kids back if they so choose? Is there a contract between the state and the parents?
So those are differences. So formal would be if the social worker comes in and takes the kids, right? And that is a legal contract between the families and the social workers with the county and everything. Probate court's involved, the judge ordered, yes, these kids need to be removed. But there's also those cases where mom or dad just dropped the kids off and there's no legality. So we work with those families to help get some sort of legal paperwork, because the parents are legally, they have the legal rights of the children. So at any time they could come in and remove the kids from grandma or whoever they're with. And a lot of times when grandma files for Medi-Cal or say cash aid, food stamps, anything like that, even Medi-Cal, they stop the financial for the parents. So then right away parents are like, oh, I'm just kidding, I want my kid back, you know? So we help with guardianship. We help prepare and print and everything, and you take the paperwork to courthouse to actually get filed. But we help you through the whole process to get some sort of legal paperwork. We help with power of attorney or caregiver affidavit. There's so many different ways to help with legal. A lot of times caregivers just don't want to go that far, but I honestly encourage every caregiver to do that, because the same reason, the parents could just pick them up and live on the street and there's nothing they can do about it.
Does the school district know that these services are available through you? Have you contacted the school district?
We've been going through different school districts, and Lib's helping us to kind of weave our way in there, because it is a little more difficult to get into the school district due to different approvals and stuff. But we're definitely trying to get out there.
Thank you.
Yes.
Do you work with children who are taking care of aging parents?
No, that would be the caregiver support program through the Department of Aging. Yes.
I read in the paper all the time there's support groups for parents of lost children. A couple years ago, I raised my granddaughter. Her mom passed away. Where are there any support groups for grieving children? Because her younger brother's going through it. Their mom passed away. And I've promised his dad that I would try and
I can do some research up in Yucca Valley. I know in Victorville there's one that's called Morning Star, and I'm not sure if they come out here. But the best thing that I would do is refer to therapy, counseling therapy, and they'll work specifically with the grieving process. And don't think about it as therapy, there's something wrong with me.
Get them to go to a group thing would be a lot easier. Because dad's down in Palm Desert, and now I've got a
Well, I'll get your name and then we can work together and find a program for you. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Any other questions?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Right. There we go. Apparently not. Okay, community officers and the community report.
Okay, our next door neighborhood social network, this is for Wonder Valley, has increased to 40 members. A lot of useful conversations are taking place, and there's a good degree of enthusiasm building. We had a community meeting this morning with 17 people in attendance. We were very happy to welcome Ignacio Nunez, code enforcement supervisor, to present. Sheriff Specialist Robert Anderson also attended and gave us crime stats for July. There were 76 calls, 9 reports, and 1 arrest. Wonder Valley neighbors Almut Fleck and Bob Tellefson suggested that we incentivize waste tire dumping, paying people to take tires to a recycling station. And if this was done like we did with beer and soda cans, for instance, if every tire had a $5 to $7 deposit that they got back on return, there would be zero tire waste in the desert. This seems like something that the MAC might suggest that the county suggests to the state. On July 25th, we had an exciting event at the Palms. High Desert Test Site sponsored Austrian artist Gerhard Tremmel, who, with his partner Edith Schwartzel, screened 9 desert short films created around stories of people who live in the Morongo Basin, including Darlene Paris, our columnist at the Desert Trail. About 100 people were present, and it was a beautiful night for films on the patio. The Wonder Valley artist Perry Hoffman is having a mail art show at the Glass Outhouse and needs people to send him postcards. Contact me if you'd like more information. And Joshua Tree artist Leslie Mariah Andrews' show starts at the Glass Outhouse at 5 on September 12th. And on a personal note, Ken and I bought our house in Wonder Valley last August, so we have now officially been here in Wonder Valley 1 year. It's true we weren't born here, but we got here as fast as we could. Thank you.
Fine.
Welcome.
Tom Siegert, I have nothing to report for Yucca Mesa.
Just setting the bar for you.
It's flat.
What?
It's flat.
Well, there's a lot of bumpy roads up there.
Flamingo Heights is still working on with Caltrans on the highway. That's going to be an ongoing thing. They're having a lot of problems with people breaking into the mailboxes and stealing mail, which is
seems to be a problem all everywhere.
Some of the things that I've got over there at one of the meetings I went to, they showed maps from Caltrans where they're doing work. So I thought it might be interesting, and I called and asked if they would send anything for this area. But it does have some from from here to Barstow and like that. So it's interesting. And I did some for the Regional Council on Aging, which we take care of people. We advocate for people.
Give them the information that's up here, and hopefully that we'll get more services and money from the county and the state.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Microphone.
Microphone.
Here, why don't you use this? It works if you just, if you don't touch it.
Can I? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's working.
All right, can you hear me?
Yes, get away from me.
How's that?
Good.
Is that better? Is that better?
Time up.
Does that work?
Hey. Can you hear me now?
How's this one?
Yes.
Okay, this one works better. Maybe if they're together, they work. Yeah. I lost where I was. As usual, Joshua Tree, second Saturday, downtown night, second Saturday of every month, 5 to 9 p.m. You can cruise around, look at the different venues that sell art, and get a pizza. And coming up September 18th to 20th is Joshua Tree International Film Festival. And they got 7 different venues downtown, although I don't know exactly what they are. I don't know if they've been named yet, but you can get a hold of them at 760-424-6861 to get information. And the Joshua Basin Water District is sponsoring a Unlocked Mysteries on Wild Crafting. And what that really means is they're going to show you how to clean native seeds, collect and clean native seeds to plant and to grow hardy, drought-tolerant plants, which is kind of interesting. That is, let me see, it is, oh wow, I didn't write down the date here. Boy, that's wrong.
The
14th? Okay, and that's at the Mojave Desert Land Trust. Yeah, there it is, okay. At 2 to 4 p.m. RSVP, okay. Pat, were you going to give that information too? Or did I step on you? Oh, good. Well, thank you. All right. And I think that's about it. August 15th, the Joshua Basin is having a workshop, a water saving workshop, and that's here at the JT Community Center on August 15th. So take a look at that, just Google it, and it'll give you the times and such. And I'd like to, on a personal note, I'd like to do a shout out. The last flood we had,
We were helping a family in South Joshua Tree that was completely flooded out, mud through the house. It covered most of the yard. It was just an enormous task, and we got a hold of the Marine Corps, and they said they could spare 5 Marines. Well, 10 showed up, and they stayed for 3 days with shovels.
Isn't that great?
Yeah, and they helped dig the house out, and it was literally under mud. They dug the house out and did a wonderful job. We just had to feed them, which cost a lot of money to feed 10 Marines. Yeah, yeah, hamburgers. Some of them were having triple and quadruple cheeseburgers. Yeah. And I'd like to give a shout out, and I'm sorry that Joshua Basin isn't here. Victoria left. Yeah, I'd like to give a shout out. I had a problem in my house here. I don't know if it was due to the flood or earth moving or what, but I had a water main blowout. And they came over today, and it was fixed, but they came over today to check the water pressure, check for leaks in the whole system to make sure that we didn't have any leaks after we repaired the water main and did a terrific job, and cleaned up after. They actually dug around the meter to make sure I didn't have any leaks, so I'd get like to say the Joshua Basin Water District is, I think, one of the better ones in the area. Yep. And that's it. Gail.
Yeah, it's working, right? Yeah, okay. First of all, I don't want to talk about Morongo Valley right now. I want to talk about the fact that tonight it came to my, a lot of things came to my attention that people are interested in having us look at, like the gun situation and the roads. And Teresa and I talked to Mark about having a meeting which will be open to the public, but where we can just throw around ideas, just more of a loose, casual meeting where we can make a list and start thinking about all the things that we should be working on, look back at what we have worked on and what's worked and what hasn't worked for us. And because I can see a lot of needs that we really haven't addressed yet that I think are important to everybody. And also I'm thinking that I just had a thought that perhaps we could have public service articles put in the newspaper that would be good for people to learn about some of these things that we learn about here, but that just don't get out to the general public. So we will, Mark is going to set up a meeting, and we'll let everybody know when that's going to be, so that we can all kind of work together in a more informal setting, I think would be a good idea. We have some things coming up in Morongo Valley at the end of September and October, and I'm going to wait till next month to talk about that. But I am very happy to say that our little, tiny, small Morongo Valley Fire Department has sent a strike team up to Humboldt County. They've been up there for a week, and we've sent a van up there to take another crew up, and then the other crew is going to come back here. So we're helping out our distant neighbors, and Morongo Valley does have a mutual aid agreement with San Bernardino County, so we do come up to Yucca Valley or Joshua Tree when we're needed with our vehicle and our guys, and we're really proud of them. Thank you.
Can I chime in real quick, Mary Helen? Can you hang on for a second? Is that, give me the sign. I know that this is a summer meeting. We don't get a big turnout in August and September. But is that something that the general public would like if the MAC got together and decided on what issues we'd like to tackle? And to your question, Peggy Lee, I did get your email and I responded to it. And the reason we haven't had any committee meetings listed or had any committee meetings lately is that we've been kind of reorganizing the MAC and putting new people on board. So we will do that. And we will have access now, I think this is for public consumption. The county has hired a secretary, part-time secretary, to man the office here at the county, the field rep's office.
Oh, are they getting a representative ever?
Yes, they are. They're in the process of doing that soon. Anyway, but my point is that the conference room will be available and we can start having those meetings again and organizing committees, and we plan on doing that. So that's something the community that Gail brought it up. I think that's something the community would appreciate. And you mentioned something else on there. What was that else? Something else that I was going to. Yeah, the committees, the availability of the conference room, which will I think, really enhance giving me. And of course, when we do meet as a group, we're going to have to advertise it as a public part of the Brown Act. So you will see an agenda come out for that. This will probably take place at probably the end of the month in August, and the beginning of September we'll get rolling on this. So thanks for your comments. Go ahead.
We're good? Okay, Mary Helen Tuttle, Copper Mountain Mesa. I've got a boatload of stuff. First of all, we had a really great breakfast. The roads to the community center were cleared just in the nick of time. So I believe it was 76 or 77 we served, and that was a lot. That was good for us. So thank you to everyone. 80 is what?
80 is the north, I'll
lay it. But you didn't come for breakfast, did you? We would have come got you, Peg. No problem. Steve was out on his tractor. He would have come get you. No excuses, sister. Okay, so coming up, we're going to go in chronological order. This Thursday, August 13th, at the Sportsman Center, is Community Back to School Day. They're going to give away backpacks. They're going to have TDEP shots and screenings. They're going to have information and sign up for school lunch program, service information for homeless or displaced students and families. And this is all going to be done at the Sportsman's Club, and the Morongo Unified School District is going to be there. So I'm sorry that those two young ladies left. That would have been good information. They did? Okay, good, good, good. Unity Home is going to be there as well, and there's going to be information on transitional age youth, that's TAY, will be there also. And the TAY Center is now run by the Valley Star Crisis Walk-In Center. So anyway, that's important at the Sportsman's Club, and it's going to be from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. this Thursday. And the student needs to be there to get a backpack. And they're pretty cool backpacks. They've got supplies in them and everything. So then after that is on Saturday is going to be the Copper Mountain Mesa movie night. At dark, we're going to show Dragnet Highway. It's going to be great. We have popcorn, we have hot dogs, we have movie snacks. Come on, Faisal, it's nice. All you have to do is bring a chair and a cooler and you just hang out. It's and I think this weekend is the Persids too, isn't it? So I don't know, I've seen a couple of shooting stars. It's gonna be a great weekend to be outside, so please come join us. And then on the next Saturday, August 22nd, is going to be the Joshua Tree Rotary Summer Splash. It's going to be here at the Community Center. There's going to be lots of fun stuff going on. But most important to you people here is we're going to have an e-waste collection. Faxes, copiers, printers, TVs, sewing machines, appliances, phones, vacuums, stereo equipment, keyboards, VCRs, lamps, old tools, all that kind of crap. Bring it. It's a fundraiser. Joshua Tree Rotary and the Park and Rec actually gets 10 cents a pound. So the heavier crap you have, the better. That's Saturday. Saturday, the 22nd, and it's from 9 to 2 here at the Community Center. Then comes Labor Day. Labor Day, we're going to have another breakfast out at the Community Center. Please come out and have one of our $5 breakfasts. You'll be hooked, I promise. And then just a quick note, in October is going to be the Morongo Basin Haven Project Connect. Morongo Basin Haven is our local resource for homeless people. And at the Sportsman's Club, they're going to have dental screening, senior services, employment, teen services, hygiene kits, and they give them a free lunch. So it's that's going to be on Thursday, October 22nd. I'll talk more about that in September and October, but if you're doing up a calendar, it's really a great event. I helped with it last year, and Morongo Basin Transit supplies a bus and gives everybody a ride, and it's just a lot of resources and a lot of, you know, free pens, stuff like that. So
Mary
thanks.
Helen?
Yeah.
Are you doing tires at the Splash?
Oh, yeah. Yes, thanks, Teresa. That's the other thing that's happening at Splash. We're going to have the county, it's either county or Mitsubishi, I don't know who it is, but they're going to have a truck there, and you can bring your old tires. I believe it is a 9-tire maximum. And no rims, just your rubber.
You can't get the damn things off if they happen in the desert. I mean, I'm sewing and
hire a young Marine. They go for triple hamburgers.
Put them in the microwave for 30 seconds. Put them in the microwave for 30 seconds.
The big microwave.
Thank you.
A lot of stuff.
Wealth of information.
You are a wealth of information. So one thing I know, and Faisal, I'd like to give you my card, if you could send me some of those photographs. For those of us who were sort of amazed that the Bureau of Land Management was going to open up off-road vehicle trails by two times what they had before, we so overwhelmed them that they went before the judge and got an extension of 120 days for additional comments.
Way to scare them back.
And so,
when does it start?
Well, first they have to get into the Federal Register, and that's not easy. But they can't do anything until they go through the next 120 days. Then they have to process them.
When does the 120 days start?
No, we don't know, because they have to go to the Federal Register. But it's going to be sometime in September. There will be a meeting that people can come to get information. But I would say that the fact that the roads are so heavily impacted by rain is a very important piece to bring up. And that's why I'm interested to have those photographs. And so hopefully we'll just inundate them again with even better arguments. I know that the idea is that you're supposed to go get the maps and you're supposed to respond to numbered routes. I looked at my area, and there were more unnumbered than numbered routes, which makes it difficult. And so, I would like to put on the what are we about to do with the road problem. Desert Heights, most of Desert Heights is not in the CSA and probably never will be. There's not the concentration of homes there. Maybe if we ever get the fire department back to where people can meet, that might happen. But the fact is, there's a 9-mile road out there called Mesa. It's the only one that goes between Copper Mountain and Wonder Valley, and it's dirt. And it's in miserable shape. And it's just going to be more in miserable shape because nobody can afford to really have a 9 miles of dirt road taken care of. I also want to say that they use some of that material to pave a ways, and I think the material, it's really not good.
It's a very crappy job on winters, believe me.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. That made me feel good, but what I notice of the county is that whenever they go to do roads, the roads get wider and wider and wider, and with this, they did not even recycle the asphalt. They just took the asphalt off the road, and that's it. That's toxic waste. So it makes it so that as water runs down when you have these problems, it undercuts it. And so it's a difficult problem. And wings may be the way we have to go. I don't know. I had to sit around and wait for half an hour before I could go home, but then I wasn't surprised. I know I get standing waves on my road. But anyway, stay tuned for the next round of WEMO. And I would be glad to help people figure out how to comment so that they understand that their plan, I don't care if we have another 120 days, it still is not a good plan. It's called the West Mojave Plan, and it's a recreational routes of travel. And the last time they came out with it several years ago with this plan, they were taken to court and they lost. And at that time, they had 5,000 and some miles that were spread across the West Mojave area. The most densely packed of areas in residential is totally through the Morongo Basin. In fact, it's the only way that you can get from one side to the other of their area. So, and then having found out that they're supposed to come back with a lesser travel plan, they doubled it. Pardon me?
Bureau of Land Management.
So you have my email, and you can ask me questions.
Have we done a resolution?
We did a resolution. And we also asked the county to stand up and say something, and they did not, as far as I know.
So maybe we need to ask
again. I think we need to ask again that the county stick up for us out here. Mm-hmm. Yes. That is a big deal.
Over an hour and a half to tell you that. That's one huge problem. And I just felt really bad being able to leave in my car and knowing that people were up there. I didn't even call. I mean, I called Mary Helen. I called.
She knows how to call.
Yeah. So I'm not saying pave all dirt roads. I'm just saying if it's a health and safety thing, you guys got to be a voice for people.
We didn't think you were.
No, we understood what you were saying.
Okay, now I remembered what I was supposed to say. Thanks. You remind me of the media. I got privilege here. I made a promise a couple of meetings ago to keep in touch with the media because we got some bad press from them, and I have been doing that.
Yes, you have.
And it has been working. We've got a story to them about the Marines that dug the house out, and they ran that. And we also gave them the story on the letter that the county wrote to Representative Chad Mays and to Caltrans, trying to get some answers on the downtown Joshua Tree problem, pedestrian problem. So actually, I wrote the press release, and they actually printed it almost as verbatim. So it's working. We're working on a relationship with the media, trying to get them on board with what we do. The other thing that you may want to listen to KZDZ, they approached us and they did profiles on everybody on the Mac here that did turn in a profile. I don't know if everybody did or not.
I did.
I did. Yeah. You didn't. Well, it's probably not too late. It was from Dan Stork. I'll try to get that information, although I think he's on vacation now.
Did you get one of those?
Anyway.
Didn't you see an email that I sent you? I said, this is me, who are you?
Anyway, they're gonna be doing profiles on each of us, and I think that for myself, and I mean the other members, I think you're gonna be surprised at the depth of what the board members here, the committee members, have actually done and how they represent the community and what they've done in the past. So it should be enlightening. So we're making headway with the press, and we're trying to do the right thing and feed them the information and getting feedback from them and just making a better Mac in general. I mean, that's it. We're adjourned. Thank you for coming.
I'm very good.